And we're now joined by former Agriculture Secretary Leonardo Montemayor. Good morning, sir. Welcome to Head Start.
Thank you very much. Good morning to everyone.
All right, sir, let's first talk about this Bigas 29 program. What are your initial reactions to this initiative?
Well, it's a welcome development. It should provide at least short-term relief to our consumers who are suffering from still relatively high prices. But the question to me really is, how long can this be sustained? Because for every kilo of rice that is sold at 29 pesos per kilo, the government will have to shell out roughly about 20 pesos per kilo in terms of subsidy in order to make that 29 pesos per kilo rice possible. So ang question talaga po rito ay ganong kahaba po yung PC o yung kumbaga yung financial wherewithal ng ating pamahalaan to sustain that this program for a long on a long basis.
Right, that actually leads me to my next question, because my next question, sir, supposedly is about the viability of this program, considering that the country has yet to significantly improve its production of rice and palay. What can you say is the long-term solution to make this program viable?
Well, it really should be maximizing all resources in order to make us capable of producing for our own domestic needs, especially for rice. This is an area where we're getting confused right now, because over the past 2 years, our farmers have been told that the objective of our government is to attain self-sufficiency in food, particularly rice, by 2028. But only recently, the president came out with an executive order 62, which practically opens the door for more rice importations, such that by and then this order will last all the way up to 2028. So the big question to us right now is, which is which? Are we really targeting self-sufficiency by 2028, or are we still going to continue this maximization of rice importation all the way to 2028?
Sir, how wise is it for the government to actually spend 20 pesos per kilo for this program? Because quite frankly, critics are saying that this is just a band-aid solution to finally deliver the Marcos Jr. promise of pulling down rice prices to 20 pesos per kilo under his administration.
Frankly, I'm at a loss, as I said earlier, on how this 29 pesos rice can be sustained over a long period, because if we are to provide this type of subsidy, let's say for this year alone, I suspect we will need easily a couple of tens of billions of pesos in order to maintain it. So the question is, how much can the government continue to do this, considering that we are still short of our goal of maximizing our food self-sufficiency, especially in rice?
Right. What are your suggestions as to where the government should instead put this tens of billions of pesos instead of creating a sort of dole-out program?
Well, as they say, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. So are we going to put the necessary funds, for example, into the budget of the Agriculture Department? I do know that the Department of Agriculture through Secretary Laurel is recommending a budget of, I think, more than 500 billion pesos for 2025. I think 513 billion. And yet what we know is that the DBM is only willing to increase the existing budget of the DA by about 10 billion pesos. So, I mean, how can we maximize food productivity and self-sufficiency if, for example, we do not have enough funds to ramp up our irrigation system, to reduce wastage through the installation of proper post-harvest facilities, and then also the construction of farm-to-market roads and so on? So we really need to show proof that our food self-sufficiency rhetoric is matched by actual budgetary infusions, especially into the Department of Agriculture.
Mr. Montemayor, to be fair to the Marcos Jr. administration, they have been investing in improving the quality of equipment of farmers in the Philippines in different provinces, as well as giving farmers more seeds, urea, and other necessities in terms of planting. But what are the loopholes that need to be addressed, considering that despite these investments in the past years, still our productivity still remains low?
Well, these programs in terms of subsidies for distribution of seeds, fertilizer inputs to our farmers are very commendable. But to me, all these are being negated by this open door policy to importation. You see, ultimately, it's going to be the price factor that will attract and encourage farmers to maximize their productivity. But for so long as I said, the policy is an open door to more imports, that will really drive down the prices, especially of palay, and this will serve as a disincentive. So baka masayang lang po lahat po itong mga subsidies sa palay, sa ano, binhi, sa machines, sa pataba, if at the end of the day, after all the efforts of farmers to maximize their production, when harvest time comes, all of these are come to naught because of very low prices brought about by a flood of imports.
Right. How do you actually encourage consumers to patronize locally produced rice compared to buying imported rice that in some cases might be cheaper?
That's still up in the air because even with this latest executive order, for example, reducing tariff rates for rice imports from 35 to 15%, because of the continuing, you know, weakness of the peso, as well as the still high prices of imported rice, which will probably remain high because of greater demand from countries like the Philippines, any reduction in tariff, for example, under EO 62, we probably will not experience a corresponding decrease in terms of the prices of rice at the retail level.
Right.
So again, we go back to the question, how long and how much is the government willing to subsidize the 29 pesos per kilo rice?
Right. I'm glad that you mentioned Executive Order 62, because while it is geared at providing consumers with cheaper alternatives in the market, how do you actually protect local farmers from this kind of incentives for the retail sector?
Well, unless you suspend or repeal EO 62, it's going to be very difficult. Because right now, we have already been receiving reports that the prices of palay have already dropped by at least 5 pesos per kilo. And that will be expected to drop further, especially when we have the main harvest towards the last quarter of this year. So, ganyan po problema po natin ngayon. Bumabagsak po yung presyo ng palay, lumiliit po yung collection po ng Bureau of Customs sa kanila pong collections po sa lower tariffs brought about the executive order. So in the end, baka po bukod sa mga mahirapan po yung ating mga magsasaka to cope up with lower prices of palay, baka hindi rin po maisasalin po yung lower tariff rates in terms of lower prices for rice for our consumers.
Mr. Montemayor, just to give our viewers a more descriptive picture of what is happening on the ground, na-mention niyo po, no, bumaba by 5 pesos per kilo yung presyo ng palay. Basically, when you have these numbers, magkano na lang po yung possible na iuwi ng mga Filipino farmers, especially in far-flung areas?
At a 5 pesos drop, palagay ko, karamihan ng mga rice farmers natin, lugi na. O at the very least, magkakaroon po sila ng substantial reduction sa kanilang kinikita mula sa kanilang pagsasaka. So kung ganun po, despite all this support coming from government in terms of more seeds, fertilizer, at the end of the day, if the farmer sees na malulugi din siya kasi babagsak lalo ang presyo po ng palay pagdating ng anihan, baka po he will no longer exert the effort needed to maximize his production, or worse, baka titigil mo muna sila sa kanilang pagtatanim at lumipat na po sila sa ibang mga pananim.
Right, and that would further worsen our food security situation? Sir, you've been in the Department of Agriculture for quite a long time. Any idea as to magkano yung take-home pay ng mga Filipino farmers?
In general, I would say less than the minimum wage. Yung tinatanggap po ng ating mga manggagawa na kwan po, karamihan po nagrereklamo, kulang na kulang po yung, in the case of Metro Manila, mga 650 pesos per day. Siguro sa rural areas po natin, roughly kalahati lang doon ang kwan po.
Around 300 pesos.
Yes, so it's hardly enough for most farmers to cope up with their daily subsistence requirements.
Add to that the fact that we are expecting a La Nina phenomenon to hit the Philippines and inundate several fields. What can the government do to prepare for that calamity?
Well, right now we have heard very little on what is being done to prepare our sector for the likely effects of a La Nina phenomenon. Tapos ang problema pa, sasabayan pa niyan ng isang man-made calamity. I'm referring now to the tariff cuts brought about by EO62. So the farmers will be hit by double whammy. A man-made calamity in the form of a tariff cut in rice, and then to be followed by a natural calamity called La Nina.
Sir, despite this double whammy that you are warning about, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., former Agriculture Secretary Marcos Jr., is expected to tout his administration's achievements during his State of the Nation address in a few weeks. What would you say is the biggest achievement of his administration in the agriculture sector?
Well, the fact that he assumed the secretaryship of the Agriculture Department during the first year and a half of his tenure, it was a good signal to everyone that he would be giving top priority to agricultural development. And then, in fairness also, during his first year in 2023, the budget of the Department of Agriculture was substantially increased by about 40% over that of 2022. So that is on the good side. But as I said, on the negative side, we have this open door policy to imports. And then I will add to that the lack of a clear-cut policy on, rejecting illegal land conversions. We hope that the president in his SONA will reiterate his statement during his first State of the Nation address in 2022 that he will make sure that a land use, national land use policy law will be approved as soon as possible. It's now 2 years since that promise. Until now, we don't see any movement in terms of the bill, especially in the Senate, moving forward.
And finally, Mr. Montemayor, on a scale of 1 to 10, how would you actually rate the Marcos Jr. administration's performance in the agriculture sector?
I'd rather make not any grading as of now. I'll just say that on the policy side, vis-a-vis the actual, position of financial support, there's still very much left to be desired.
All right. Thank you so much for making time for us this morning, former Agriculture Secretary Leonardo Montemayor.
Thank you.